How am I? I'm doing great. I have way more time to handle projects and to talk to people that I normally don't get a chance to talk to. I get some me time to stop running around and actually sit, rest, and cook good food. And it's really been great. How am I really? Work is way too much. I worked less when I was at work. I'm working more at home. I'm very lonely because I'm a people person and I like being out with the crowd. Financially, I'm struggling because I'm used to being out gigging more and to not do all those extra gigs has been a burden on me financially. How am I personally? Just staying at home is miserable because I'm a people person and to just not be out giving people hugs and handshakes and all that has really weighed on me, but God is keeping me.
How are you doing, Mom?
I'm doing okay. A long time ago, I discovered one thing. When you are facing hard times that you cannot control, you take it one day at a time. And if one day is too long a period of time, how about taking it a half day? Or even an hour at a time? Because God gave you a brain to think about it. He gave you a heart to pray with. And as long as you have that combination, you can simply say, Lord, give me the strength to move ahead. And you move forward. Even if it's a minute, an hour, a day, at a time. Don't swallow more than you can deal with. Don't worry about the next month, because we aren't there yet. Don't even worry about next week, because we aren't there yet. But as long as you focus on the minute, the hour, the day at a time, you can make it. Because good Lord has given you the strength to do that. And He's given you the mind to make the choice about the span of time you're going to deal with. And then when you reach the end of hard times, you can look back, oh, I made it. And that's what I have to focus on now. I can't control what happens next week or next month or even next year because it's not here yet. But I can focus on this minute, this hour, this day, and I will get through that. And if the burden gets too hard to bear, Lord, give me the strength to get through this time. And He will. And so you go ahead. You keep moving forward. And that's what we have to do.
All of God's promises are yes and amen. Let us sing of His promises.
Father of kindness, you have poured out grace. You brought me out of darkness. Fill me with peace. Giver of mercy, you have helped in time of need. Lord, I can't help but sing. Faithful you are. Faithful you are. merciful Savior, you have brought me near. You pulled me from the ashes, you have broken every curse. Blessed Redeemer, you have set this captive free. Lord, I can't help but sing, faithful. Faithful you are, faithful forever you will be, faithful you are. All your promises, yes, amen. All your promises are yes and amen. Faithful you are. Faithful forever you will be. Faithful you are. Yes, you are. All your promises are yes and amen. Yes, all your promises are yes and amen. Oh, oh. Yes and amen, God. I will rest in your promise. My confidence is your faithfulness. I will rest in your promises. My confidence, God, is your faithfulness. I will rest in your promises. My is your faithfulness. I will rest in your promises. My confidence is your faithfulness. Faithful you are, God. Yes, you are. Faithful forever you will be. Faithful you are, faithful you are. All your promises are yes and amen. Faithful you are, we serve a faithful God. Faithful forever and ever you will be. Faithful you are, hey. All your promises are yes and amen. God made us a promise. All your promises are yes and amen. Oh, all your promises are yes and amen.
Hola, mi nombre es Marta López. Padre que estás en los cielos, gracias te damos en este día. Estamos contentos, felices, porque tú nos has dado este momento y hemos pasado por muchas cosas. Hemos recibido muchos problemas, pero hemos recibido también de ti muchas bendiciones. Gracias, Señor, porque tú eres nuestro refugio, tú eres nuestro amparo y fortaleza. Y hemos reconocido que tú eres nuestro Dios, un Dios poderoso que siempre nos libra del mal, nos bendice y un día nos guiará hacia donde tú estás. Gracias, Padre, por todo. Gracias por tus bendiciones. En Cristo Jesús. Amén. Dear God, on this day we want to thank you We know you have been with us in a lot of things, maybe bad things that have happened to us, but so wonderful things that you also have given us. And we love you, and we know that you have taken us by your hand through all whatever has come to our way, and we've been blessed by you. We know you love us, and you are always and will be always our refuge, and we know for sure you're gonna take care of us. We are your children, we are your people, and you are our awesome God. Thank you, thank you, thank you. In Jesus' name, amen.
How are you really doing? Different people and personalities are coping in many different ways during this season in our world. Some feel the isolation, loneliness, and depression. Others are panicking over job loss and financial hardship, while some throw themselves into their work and goals, while others are frozen with fear. No matter how you are feeling, there's always another way to take shelter. It's time to take shelter in God.
How are you doing? Is this global pandemic bringing out the best in you, perhaps? If so, can you help me? Because I'm about to kill my family. Not literally, please don't call the police or Child Protective Services, but they are driving me nuts. And for those of you who don't know me, I am generally a fairly even-keeled person. You know, I'm pretty good at seeing the best in people, of overlooking flaws, of just being kind, and perhaps it's the recovering people pleaser in me, but I'm a generally fairly balanced, relaxed person. But there are two people that can make me lose my cool quicker than anybody else. And it's pretty incredible that they have mastered this skill so quickly, because they are 1 and 3 years old. And what generally happens as this day unfolds is perhaps the nap was skipped, and these girls share the same bedroom. So if one doesn't nap, the other doesn't nap. And then when they wake up, there's a lack of listening, there are tantrums, there are meltdowns, there's fighting, there's lack of understanding, there's just refusal to listen to anything rational. And that's just on my part. So perhaps you're in a similar boat, where you are just at your end, where you need God to provide, whether it's relief from this coronavirus, whether it's physically, mentally, spiritually. Maybe you need God to provide financially. Perhaps you've lost your job or been furloughed during this time. Maybe you need God to provide for you emotionally. Perhaps you are like me and you're at your wit's end and you are just going stir crazy. You need God's provision of sanity. Or maybe this has brought you into a place of depression and darkness and despair, and you need God's provision of hope. Well, if that's you this morning, I want to say welcome to Mosaic Church. You are in the right place, because even godly men and women need God's provision and go through dark times. And this morning we are going to look at one of the spiritual giants in the Bible, the prophet Elijah. And as we pick up this story in 1 Kings 19, we see a man depressed, ready to die, and desperately in need of God's provision. Let's take a look at God's word.
Now Ahab had told Jezebel everything Elisha had done and how he killed all the prophets with the sword. So Jezebel sent a messenger to Elijah to say, "May the God deal with me, be it ever so severely, if by this time tomorrow I do not make your life like that of one of them." Elijah was afraid and ran for his life. When he came to Beersheba in Judah, he left his servant there, while he himself went a day's journey into the wilderness. He came to a broom bush, sat down under it, and prayed that he might die. "I have had enough, Lord," he said. "Take my life. I am no better than my ancestors. Then he lay down under the bush and fell asleep. All at once, an angel touched him and said, "Get up and eat." He looked around, and there by his head was some bread baked over hot coals and a jar of water. He ate and drank and then lay down again. The angel of the Lord came back a second time and touched him and said, "Get up and eat, for the journey is too much for you." So he got up and ate and drank. Strengthened by that food, he traveled 40 days and 40 nights until he reached Horeb, the mountain of God. There he went into a cave and spent the night.
Can you relate to Elijah? If so, I'm glad you're here, because we are in this sermon series called Shelter in God. And we've looked at what it means to shelter in God's peace, to shelter in God's promises, and today we look at what it means to shelter in God's provision. And Elijah certainly needed God to provide. We see that Elijah in 1 Kings 19, he takes shelter three different places. And the first place he takes shelter is under a broom bush in the wilderness, where he has reached this place of desperation, and he's crying out to God that he might die. Now you might think, if you've looked at the prophet Elijah, how did he get there? Because if you read the chapters just leading up to this, Elijah has just taken on the prophets of Baal, and he has proven that God is the one true God, and he's taken out all the prophets of the false god Baal. And there's been a drought in the land for years, and Elijah, when God told him to, he prayed and the rain came. He has seen God do miracles through him, with the rain, also with healings and provision. Elijah is this giant in the faith. Yet when the queen Jezebel, queen of Israel, hears that Elijah has wiped out the prophets of Baal, she threatens his very life. And we see Elijah on the run, filled with this depression, filled with this suicide, hiding under a broom bush in the wilderness. I'm reminded of the Mother Teresa, of what came out in 2003 about Mother Teresa. She had passed away, and after she passed away, her letters came out. And she wrote about this dark night of the soul that she experienced. She had seasons where she felt like her prayers were empty, where she couldn't feel God's presence. And she kept serving, kept going to God, kept doing ministry faithfully, incredibly, with the poorest of the poor in Calcutta, India, to the point where so many were surprised that Mother Teresa experienced any sort of depression or darkness, because she was such a light and a hope to so many. So if the prophet Elijah and Mother Teresa can go through seasons of darkness, there's no shame for you and for me going through them either. And there's something important we see in common between the two. Going through seasons like this, the first thing they do is they cry out to God. We see in 1 Kings chapter 19, verse 4, it says, Elijah came to a broom bush, he sat down under it, and he prayed that he might die. "I've had enough, Lord," he said, "take my life, I am no better than my ancestors." He cried out to God for his provision. And I don't know about you, but sometimes I tend to cry out on Facebook, or I tend to cry out to Google, searching for answers. Or I cry out to a friend or a counselor. And God can use crying out to friends and counselors. Those are good sources and outlets, especially if you're reaching out to godly men and women. But the important thing is to cry out to God, to cry out to the one who is known as Jehovah Jireh, which means the Lord will provide, because God wants to provide for us. God wants us to cry out to him, and God won't chastise us. He already knows what's going on in your heart. He knows how you feel. God won't shame you for being weak, because God has already said in 2 Corinthians 12:9 that when we are weak, that's when he's strong. our weakness and confessing our weakness to God actually gives him the opportunity to come in and move in powerful ways, to provide. And now God also doesn't always answer our prayers the way we expect. You see, Elijah prayed that he might die, but God had other plans. God wanted to use the prophet Elijah. God knew things that were happening behind the scenes that Elijah didn't even know about yet. And I love how God provides, because you see, God provides physically. He sends comfort food, fresh baked bread. Who doesn't love fresh baked bread? And a jar of water. And an angel wakes Elijah up. He eats, he drinks. And then I love this. He lays back down again. If you've ever gone through depression, you know that even eating or drinking can take energy. And God doesn't shame him for that either. But then God comes, sends an angel a second time to wake Elijah up. He says, eat, drink, or the journey will be too much for you. So Elijah gets up a second time. He eats, he drinks, and then he sets out on this 40-day journey. God has provided physically, but I'd also argue that God has provided spiritually and emotionally. God has given Elijah hope in the midst of his pain. And I don't know what's going on with you in the midst of our current circumstances. Some are dealing with loneliness and isolation. Others are dealing with chaos and just completely overwhelmed. In the Picardo household, with Pastor Roz and I both trying to work full time with two toddlers and me being 7 months pregnant, we are just trying to make it one day at a time. And we are crying out to God for sanity, for patience, for just energy to make it through the day. And it's been so wonderful to see how God's provided, because God's provided for us with physical gifts. It comes in the simplest of forms. Sometimes it's in the form of stickers. God has sent us muffin mix with cute little muffin wrappers to bake muffins with the girls. God has sent us a family photo session to give us a break from the mundane, a chance to dress up and capture memories from this crazy season. God has provided with bubbles. Who knew bubbles could be an answer to God's prayer? But it's incredible how God has provided in such little ways physically that have brought us hope, that have reminded us that we're not alone, that have reminded us that we are loved, that have reminded us that we have a church family and we are better together. And God has showed up when we cried out. We have seen God's provision. So where do you need God's provision today? I encourage you, cry out to God. We have a God who cares for us, who loves you so desperately, who will meet those needs, not in the way you necessarily expect him to, but God wants to provide. So shelter in God's provision.
There he went into the cave and spent the night, and the word of the Lord came to him. "What are you doing here, Elijah?" he replied. "I have been very zealous for the Lord God Almighty."
"The Israelites have rejected your covenant, tore down your altars, and put your prophets to death with the sword. I am the only one left, and now they are trying to kill me too."
The Lord said, "Go out and stand on the mountain in the presence of the Lord, for the Lord is about to pass by."
Then a great and powerful wind tore the mountains apart and shattered the rocks before the Lord, but the Lord was not in the wind. After the wind, there was an earthquake, but the Lord was not in the earthquake. After the earthquake came fire, but the Lord was not in the fire. And after the fire came a gentle whisper.
1 Kings 19:9-12.
40 nights, Elijah, whose name means "the Lord is my God," came to the mountain of God, Mount Horeb, also known as Mount Sinai. It's the same mountain on which Moses received the Ten Commandments. Elijah wanted to meet up with God, run from the situation, and so where does he go? Into a cave, sheltering in place. What are you doing here, Elijah? Isn't that a good question to ask in the middle of a crisis? What is Elijah's outlook on the whole deal? The situation is bad, bad, and bad. I've done everything right the way you directed me to, God. I've been on fire for you. But the people you chose have rejected your promises, broken down all things holy, and killed all your workers. And I'm the only one left. And now they're trying to kill me too. Was Elijah sold out for God? Yes. Did many other people in the nation break promise with God? Yes. Is there a reason to fear? Yes. King Ahab and Jezebel are carrying out death threats. But is Elijah the only one left faithful to God? Really? When you're sheltering in place, it's so easy to become very narrow-minded and self-pitying, along with self-righteous, believing that you're the only one, blaming everyone else for the situation and for their decision-making. This self-righteous and poor me attitude overshadows what God is doing and what God wants to do through you. This attitude and negative thinking even overshadows what God is providing. When we are sheltering in God's provision, however, we need to listen up. If we want to receive what God is providing, if we tune out, we can miss out on a tremendous blessing. So in the cave, God responds to Elijah's fears. God responds to our fears. It may be that Elijah does not even know what he needs God to provide, but he is in the midst of this crisis and needs to trust God. So Elijah is used to God providing in the spectacular. The wind tears off the face of the mountain, but God is not in the powerful wind. There's an earthquake, but God isn't in the earthquake. God was not in the fire or flame, not in the earth, wind, or fire. But after the fire was a gentle whisper. Could it be during this time of sheltering in God through COVID-19, could God be wanting to speak to us in a new way? The old ways were great and worked then, but is God wanting to get our attention in a new way now? What is God speaking to me in my chaos called quarantine? In the breaking of my routine, in the upending of my plans, I need to ask God, what do you need me to hear in the middle of this shelter? What, oh God, do you want me to receive that you are providing like no other time? God wants to teach us something, and we can learn many things, but we need to pay attention and listen up. You may want to make a list of everything you are learning, lessons and perspectives you never want to forget as a result of being in this COVID cave listening for God. Here's the beginning of a short list for me. Power of routine. Spirit, mind, and body. Listen, I got out of routine with everything I did pre-COVID. Through some seasonal depression and just kind of wallowing in my own self-pity, I stopped doing the things that I could. And God said, listen up, get up, get back into devotional reading and Bible listening and seeking me so spirit and mind is restored. How about body? The COVID-15 is real. Gaining a half pound a day for 15 days is real. Missing out on my gym classes and spin classes has left me a little out of control eating ice cream every night. Listen up. Hey, seize the power of the routine and cut the portions down. What else am I learning that God doesn't want me to miss? He doesn't want me to be afraid to try new things. Feel the fear and sign up for Zoom anyway. I would never have thought we could have celebrated birthday parties, game nights, family gatherings around Pictionary, seeing each other online. God provides a way. I would have never wanted to start one men's huddle meeting virtually, let alone two. But now there are 30 women and men who are relating on a deeper level because of three new online groups through Mosaic. What else? Take care of the most vulnerable. It's not about me. If I wear a mask, it's not for me. It's to help stay the spread of this potentially dangerous virus to someone else. If I practice physical distancing, it's because I'm learning to love in a distant way. It's not because I'm not excited to see someone. What else? I'm growing an appreciation of the unnoticed. I appreciate not having to leave the house to get a haircut, and I'm just fine. God provides, unnoticed and unseen. But really, I appreciate the men and women who work behind the scenes to deliver all manner of things to stores and our door, who work unseen, stocking shelves, work the checkout lanes, and gather clean and sanitize carts from the grocery stores. Unseen before, greatly appreciated now, those hardworking in the background. Relationally, what am I learning? What are you learning? What do you appreciate that you've taken for granted before? You know, I almost missed it with Trisha. I'm wallowing around in what I can't do, where I can't go, and she's right here. Sure, we need to work differently, but wow, there is significant time that I can listen more deeply and what's going on in her heart and mind. How about you and the kids then? What is God showing you? How has God been speaking to you in a different way? Did you almost miss it? Was there a moment when you finally heard? Maybe that's this morning or this afternoon. When we seek God in all the former ways we've experienced, like Elijah the Great, that great, great man of God, we can miss God in the shelter. But God is proving that the presence of the Holy Spirit is found in a gentle whisper. Remember, God says through the prophet Zechariah, it's not by might nor by power, but by my Spirit, says the Lord Almighty. It's not by work nor by exercising an excessively sharp mind, but by listening up to my Spirit, says God. God may be providing a new way to hear and experience the power presence of Jesus through this COVID-19 crisis. When we come to the end of ourselves, that's where God begins. And certainly Elijah coming to the end of himself. If you want to shelter in God's provision, you've got to cry out, but then you've got to listen up, because God will speak. God is listening. Yeah, God is speaking, and we are to listen. Are you simply sheltering in place, or are you sheltering in God's provision?
1 Kings chapter 19, verse 13 through 18 reads, when Elijah heard it, he pulled his cloak over his face and went out and stood at the mouth of the cave. Then a voice said to him, what are you doing here, Elijah? He replied, I have been very zealous for the Lord God Almighty. The Israelites have rejected your covenant, torn down your altars, and put your prophets to death with the sword. And I am the only one left, and now they are trying to kill me too. The Lord said to him, go back the way you came and go to the desert of Damascus. When you get there, anoint Hazael, king over Aram. Also, anoint Jehu, son of Nimshi, king over Israel, and anoint Elisha, son of Shaphat from Abel Meholah, to succeed you as prophet. Jehu will put to death any who escape the sword of Hazael, and Elijah will put to death any who escape the sword of Jehu. Yet I reserve 7,000 in Israel, all whose knees have not bowed down to Baal and whose mouths have not kissed him.
When we are sheltering in God's provision, the first thing we have to do is cry out to God. As Callie pointed out, Elijah did this when he was under the broom tree, and God responded to Elijah's needs, and God can respond to our needs too. Then, as Pastor Wave pointed out, we have to listen up while we're in the cave and how God can respond to our fears. But then there's another step, and that is to go forth under God's provision, that God responds with hope for our future, just as he did Elijah's. Twice in this passage, God is asking Elijah why he's depressed. And twice Elijah responds with a mixture of truth and error. And it goes to show us that we must confront the lie. We must confront the lie that's in front of us. For Elijah, he says, I've been zealous for you, which is true. Then he says, the Israelites have rejected you, which is also true. They have killed your prophets, God, and that's true. However, he says this, I am the only one left, which is false. God's got 7,000 faithful people in Israel Elijah doesn't know anything about. and that God is about to raise up in these mighty warriors. And he's going to raise up a guy by the name of Elisha that is going to have a double portion of Elijah's Holy Spirit anointing power as well. And of course, the lineage goes on to Jesus being the fulfillment of all this. He feels like he is left alone, but he's not. He has three true premises in this, but a false conclusion. And this is how depression and despair often works. It's the momentum of things that are true that ultimately lead lost conclusion. It's all lost, we say to ourselves. God, it's useless. My family will never change. My friends will never listen to me. My workplace won't value me. It's never going to get any better. I'm not going to find anybody who cares about me. I'll never be happy. And all of a sudden, our depressed self is whispering these conclusions to us. And we have to stop listening to them in the name of Jesus and send them right back to the pits of hell where they came from. You see, you must defy them. You must defy your depressed self. Stop listening to the lies and start talking. Start proclaiming God's word, God's truth, and God's promises of provision. And don't mumble them, but boldly proclaim them. Take hold of yourself and be assured that God loves you and cares for you, that you are not alone in your greatest hour of need, that your future is not dim because of the resurrection, that you may not be happy right now, but you can be joyful because happiness depends on our happenings, but joy is found in the Holy Spirit. So we have to rebuke our depression and sadness that its days are numbered. You see, it's okay to have those feelings of being alone and depressed and sad. But when we stay in those feelings and it becomes something that we end up going to often and staying in, that's where it becomes the problem. Verses 15 through 18, God reveals to Elijah his plan. He's working in a pagan king Elijah's never heard of to bring judgment on Ahab and Jezebel. And he's got 7,000 secret agents in Israel Elijah knows nothing about. You see, Elijah, like you and I, often put God in a box. However, he expected that God could work only one way, and then God shows him a different way of working. Elijah thinks that God has let him down, and that God has not let him down. Elijah's only limited his view of God and how God works. You ever get to the stage in your life when you look back and you see that a time when it looked like God was absent, he was actually at work doing something good? If already from your limited perspective, you can look back and see a purpose for some of your pain and struggle in your life, don't you think that given enough time and perspective, you'll be able to see a purpose for all of it? Friends, it's time for you and I to get back to our assignment. I mean, this story ends with God telling Elijah to get back to business of being a prophet, giving the word of God, anointing kings, and training up men and women of God. For you, though, whatever you should be doing right now, no matter how despondent you feel doing it, you need to get back to doing it. Whether it's being a dad, a mom, a wife, or a faithful husband, a student, a good employee, a witness to your friends and family, a God-honoring, gospel-demonstrating boss or employee, and being steadfast, immovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord, knowing that your labor is not in vain, and that we work with all we have in us as we are working for the Lord and not humans. See, God is working. He's always working. And brothers and sisters, it's time to shelter in God's provision. For you, it may be time to cry out to God, which means to humble ourselves. Or it might be time to listen up while we're in the cave. Maybe you are experiencing some cave time right now and you need to listen up. Or maybe it's time to go forth in the power of the Holy Spirit and get back to business, whatever it is. God's got you. Find your shelter in God today, in God's provision. God hasn't abandoned you. God has not left you nor forsaken you. God is not mad at you, but God is mad about you. He loves you. Now it's time for you and I to go after God with all our hearts. In the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, and God's people said, amen.
Some of you know my background and know that I have a limited church experience growing up. So when I was going off to college, finding a church was really not part of anywhere in the realm of my thinking. That changed, however, during my junior year of college when I met someone in my physics class. He invited me to church, and as we're sitting there, I saw him put money in a plate, and I asked him what it was for. And he said it was a tithe, that it helps a church follow its mission. So then I asked him, well, how do you know how much to put in the plate? He said, well, the Bible says to give 10%. And he showed me in Malachi, chapter 3, verse 10, where it says, bring the whole tithe into the storehouse, that there may be food in my house. Test me in this, says the Lord Almighty, and see if I will not throw open the floodgates of heaven and pour out so much blessing that there will not be enough room to store it. I thought, okay. So then I asked him, but do you tithe on the net or the gross amount? He said, in return, well, which one do you want God to bless? Well, I made $80 every 2 weeks working at the university library, so I began writing a check for $8 every 2 weeks and put it into the offering plate. As time went on, I met Wayne. We got married, bought a house, and we continued to tithe. Well, then Wayne felt the call to ministry. So he changed jobs. His job actually went, income almost went down to zero, and we began living paycheck to paycheck while he went to seminary. I told Wayne, if God called you to go to seminary, then he's going to have to pay for it. We had little savings, and I definitely didn't want to go into debt. There were times when I was tempted to save the tithe check, put it towards his tuition and books, but I didn't. We continued to trust in God's provision, and provide he did. Money came in over time just when we needed it through scholarships, education reimbursement funds, and in the end, we only had to pay for one quarter. In these uncertain times, when we don't know what the future holds, it can be hard to trust in God's provision. We've heard some people receive the stimulus check and thought, this is God's provision, and this is what I need to pay for bills and food. Others tithed on it, while others we've heard gave the entire amount to a charitable organization or a person in need. We are all in the same COVID-19 storm, but we are all in different boats with different needs. But take comfort in that we know that we are not alone. Just as God told Elijah he was not alone in his faith and ministry, neither are you. Mosaic is here to help you through this storm. Together we can weather the storm. Mosaic has launched the Corona 19 Fund to help our brothers and sisters in Christ by providing finances to help meet the needs like meals, groceries, gift cards, etc. Thank you to those who have already given funds and helped to be the hands and feet of Christ. Thank you also to those that have continued to give to the general budget. Your faithfulness will help Mosaic be the church that he has called us to be today and in the next season. There are three ways you can give. One, you can give on the Mosaic app, or two, through our website at www.wearemosaic.org/give. Or three, you can mail a check to 70 Birch Alley, Suite 240, Beaver Creek, Ohio, 45440. No matter which boat you are in, our prayer for you is that you cry out to God, listen up, and go forth trusting in his provision, that he will be faithful in providing for all of your needs.
Good morning, Mosaic. I hope you can join me this morning for worship.
There is a shaking, let hearts awaken. Our God is moving, forever changing us. There is a trembling, there is revival, the sound of worship, so great and glorious. Holy Spirit, hear us now, breathe on us, holy fire fall, come and fill this place with your presence, like a rushing wind, send your spirit here, rest. There is a shaking, let hearts awaken. Our God is moving, forever changing us. There is a trembling, there is revival. The sound of worship, so great and glorious. Holy Spirit, hear us now. Breathe on us, holy fire fall. Come and fill this place with your presence. Like a rushing wind, send your spirit here. Breath of heaven, breathe on us. Breath of heaven, breathe on us. Come breathe on us. Come breathe on us. Come breathe on us. Lift up your hands and shout, the Lord is with us now. Lift up your voice and sing, He is holy. Lift up your hands and shout, the Lord is with us now. Lift up your voice and sing, He is holy. Lift up your hands and shout, the Lord is with us now. Lift up your voice and sing, He is holy. Lift up your hands and shout, the Lord is with us now. Lift up your voice and sing. Oh, breathe on us, holy fire fall. Come and fill this place with your presence. Like a rushing wind, send your spirit here. Breath of heaven, breathe on us. Breathe on us, holy fire fall. Come and fill this place with your presence. Like a rushing wind, send your spirit here. Breath of heaven, breathe on us. Breath of heaven, breathe on us. Come breathe on us. Come breathe on us. Oh, yeah.
Thank you for worshiping with us this morning. We would love to continue to connect with you throughout the week, and here are a few ways how. We have a men's huddle group that meets on Tuesdays at 8:45 p.m., as well as another group that meets on Thursdays at 5:30 a.m. We have a women's Bible study group that also meets on Tuesdays at 8 p.m., and they are studying fear and faith. On Wednesdays, we have a student ministry Bible study that meets at 3 p.m., and we close out the day with a virtual prayer time at 9 p.m. On Thursdays, we have a Zoom game for Mosaic Kids at 3 o'clock p.m. Mosaic, we love you, we miss you, and we hope to see you online. Thank you.